गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीबॉडी। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ इंटास फार्मास्यूटिकल्स आई डॉक्टर शशिकांत शर्मा कॉर्डियली वेलकम द डिस्टिंग्विश्ड मॉडरेटर्स एंड द स्पीकर ऑफ टुडेज पीजी प्रोग्राम। ऑन द फर्स्ट डे ऑफ दिस प्रोग्राम द सेशन वॉज ऑन अप्लाइड एनाटॉमी ऑफ द विट्रियस एंड रेटिना। ऑन द सेकेंड डे इट वॉज ऑन हाउ टू डू इनडायरेक्ट ऑफ्थल्मोस्कोपी एंड ऑन द थर्ड डे इट वॉज ऑन when to order FFA and analyzing FFA. Today is the fourth day of this PG training program. Several new participants must have joined us today. So let me take this opportunity to introduce to all of you the eminent moderators and the speaker of today's webcast. Dr. Saurav Sinha is an executive director at BBI Foundation, Kolkata. He has been in exclusive VR practice for the last 20 years. He was a consultant at Shankar Netralay Chennai and then the medical director at SN Kolkata. He has delivered more than 250 talks at international and national meetings. Dr. Saurav Sinha is one of the moderators of today's PG program. Dr. Satyajit Sinha, a renowned cataract and glaucoma surgeon, is the director of ABI Institute Patna. Presently, he is the academic and research committee member East of AIOS. He is the recipient of several prestigious awards and has been invited as guest faculty at numerous national and state conferences since 2005. He has been chief instructor and co-instructor for international, national and state conferences since 2001. Dr. Satyajit Sinha is also one of the moderators of today's program. Dr. Pooja Sinha, a senior vitreo-retinal consultant at ABI Institute Patna, did her vitreo-retinal fellowship from Shankar Netralay Chennai. Earlier, she was attached with vitreo-retinal department of Stanford University, USA and Oxford Radcliffe Hospital, Hull Royal Infirmary, UK. She served as chief instructor for instruction course on indirect ophthalmoscopy at AIOS, DOS and SARC meets. Awarded with Dr. D.K. Bose Gold Medal for the Best Paper Presentation and Appreciation Award for her work from national and international society like UNICEF. Dr. Pooja Sinha is also one of the moderators of today's PG program. Dr. Krishnendu Nandi, a senior VR consultant at BBI Foundation, Kolkata, did his fellowship in vitreo-retinal surgery from Shankar Netralay Chennai. He is the recipient of the prestigious Dr. B.K. Mitra Award. He has several international and national index journal publications to his credit. He is the eminent speaker of today's PG program. Now, may I request Dr. Saurav Sinha to please take over the charge of today's proceedings. Dr. Saurav Sinha, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Sharma. I welcome back my friend, Dr. Nandi, for today's lecture. Dr. Krishnendu, unlike the first day where I was having to call you back again and slides going back, for the last 2 days, what we've been doing is, as you show 2-3 slides, we stop and we discuss and we go ahead because the net connections are not so smooth. So going back 5 or 10 slides is a little difficult. So we will discuss as you go along.
Okay.
At any point, if you feel you want to overrule my suggestion, please go ahead with the presentation and then we can come back to questions later on. Thank you. Welcome, Satyajit and Pooja. Shall we go ahead, Dr. Nandi, with your talk today, please?
Yeah, can I start?
Yes, please.
So again, I thank my moderators, ABI Institute, Dr. Chandrasekhar, Dr. Satyajit Sinha, Dr. Saurav Sinha. So I'll be presenting on update on diabetic retinopathy today. So diabetes is a major health problem in India. So if you can see this 2011 last increase, there is a prevalence of diabetes in India. And if you can see the statistics, at that time was in million, these figures in millions. So the newly diabetic, non-diabetic patient is 1.2 million PDR at that point of time. So it must have increased by this point. So why the diabetic patient lose their vision? Because of 2-3 reasons. Why? First is the edema, that is the fluid collection at the macular area. Second is the vitreous hemorrhage. And third is tractional or combined retinal detachment. This is the main cause of loss of vision in diabetic patient. So let us see what is a brief about pathogenesis. It's mainly the compromised microvascular circulation of the retinal capillaries. So mainly it leads to, there is a glycosylated end product leading to loss of pericytes and leaky capillary vessels. So it is the main two reasons why the capillary vessel pathology occurs. One is leakage, another is occlusion. So what are the condition, what is the example of leakage? Is capillary retinal hemorrhages, dot, blot, flame-shaped hemorrhage. Example of leakage is macular edema, lip is exudation, there is a heart exudation, is the example of leakage.
Dr. Sindhu,
yes.
Just 1 second. Yeah. We had an excellent class by you on the first day.
Yeah.
And where you showed the flame-shaped hemorrhages,
yes,
in the superficial air.
Yes.
And we had an excellent class yesterday by Dr. Manisha Agarwal, who showed us the on the leakage and the angiography.
Yeah.
So I will now put a question to all our participants. 50 odd people have already come in. Fastest finger first. So my first question is, the macular edema in diabetic maculopathy, what is the kind of leakage that you, the pattern of leakage, what is it called by name? What is it called? That's my first question. And my second question is, the dot and blot hemorrhages, what layer of the retina are they in? Dr. Krishnendu taught us this on the first day. In which layers do we get the dot and blot hemorrhages? And in which layer do we get the flame-shaped hemorrhages? So three questions. Which layer flame-shaped hemorrhages? Which layer dot and blot? Hypofluorescence. Donna, I agree hypofluorescence, but what kind of hypofluorescence? We discussed that yesterday, if you attended yesterday's class. We'll go ahead with the presentation, Dr. Krishnendu.
Yeah, this all answer, I am going to give you the all answer in my presentation. So the example of occlusion, there's next is next to leakage is occlusion. Example of occlusion is a soft exudate in the nerve fiber layer. Retinal ischemia, hypoxia, arteriovenous shunts, that is known as IRMAs, and lastly, neovascularization. So these are the results, examples of occlusion. So if you can see the classification of diabetic retinopathy, it is classified as either non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy or proliferative diabetic retinopathy, depending upon the presence of neovascularization. And there is another classification of diabetic macular edema, presence of fluid at the center of the fovea. So if you can classify, this is a broad classification. So if you can reclassify again, the non-proliferative diabetic macular edema is classified as mild, moderate, and severe, depending upon the presence of cotton wool spot, venous bleeding, and IRMAs. So this slide is very important, often asked in the Viva and written examination, that what is severe NPDR 4-2-1 rule, that is a hard exudate microaneurysm present in all quadrant, venous bleeding 2 quadrant, IRMA at 1 quadrant. Very severe NPDR, at least 2 or more of the severe NPDR if present, that is known as very severe NPDR. Then comes to the PDR, that is neovascularization elsewhere or neovascularization of the disc. So there is a definition of the neovascularization of the disc. Neovascularization of the disc are within 1 disc diameter of the center. That is neovascularization of the disc. Elsewhere, anywhere, if you can find the neovascularization. So based on neovascularization, you can classify high-risk PDRs. Like if the neovascularization extends more than 1/3 of the disc, if the neovascularization associated with vitreous hemorrhage or neovascularization elsewhere, more than 1/3 of the disc diameter and with vitreous hemorrhage. So these are the high-risk criteria of PDR. So this is the slide, which is very important. We often find leakage in diabetic macular edema. If you can see the color fundus photograph, a lot of hard exudate with center, there's a leaking microaneurysm, which increase in size and intensity as the time passes by. And this is the slide I have shown you, the first presentation, on my retina presentation. This is where the dot and blot hemorrhages lies, this layer, flame-shaped hemorrhages at this layer, macular edema, and hard exudates.
So Dr. Nandi, one second. Dr. Nandi, yeah. One second. Very nice, excellent slides. Can we go back to your FAF slide, angiography slide, please?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Now, we discussed a lot on these things yesterday, and I this is a very clean, nice photograph that you have shown. So, I can see in the right, the left upper one, a lot of hard exudates at the macular area, which you are showing exactly. And I can see some hemorrhages are just inside the superior arcade also, very prominent. Yes, what you're showing the pointer over there. Now, that point that you're showing over there, in the consecutive three FA slides, let us see the hemorrhage over there, the hemorrhage that you showed, yes. So this, I want to ask, yes, again here, same size, and in third one also same here. So I want people to look at these, all of us PGs. So this is a hypofluorescence of what kind? That is the question I'm asking. Yesterday's class, blocked, yes. Anushri Rajni, very nice. Dr. Rajni, I would like, and Dr. Charul. So Priyanka, Dr. is missed out. So I'll ask Dr. Anushri, Dr. Charul, and Dr. Priyanka, Dr. Charul. See if you to please post which college you are from and which place that is in. We would like to acknowledge you for having listened so carefully to yesterday's class and today's presentation also. Thank you so much, Anjali. We know our Christian that they learned a lot yesterday. Can we go ahead to the next slide, please? Thank you so much.
So this slide I have explained previously also. So next is the pre-retinal hemorrhage. See the figure where the pre-retinal hemorrhage accumulates, and this is the florid neovascularization of the disc. And then there is a vitreous hemorrhage. Completely obliterates the view of the retina. So this is one of the major cause of vision loss in diabetic patients. Other than that, what we can find in FFA in diabetic patient is retinal ischemia. See, there is area of capillary dropout, and there are a lot of collaterals here. See the area of hard exudate at the center of the fovea and cottonal spots. And IRMA, intraretinal microvascular abnormalities. So the people can, examiner can ask you question, what is the difference between the IRMA and neovascularization? How can you differentiate between the IRMA and neovascularization? One of the questions. And this here, you can see there is a gross neovascularization of the disc and neovascularization elsewhere in a patient of diabetic. So
You made the question and you just let it by. So if you can help us by understanding the IRMA and the NVE, clinically, when you see for somebody who's seeing for the first time, by with the 78 diopter, let us see they are seeing, what is the difference that they will see? What does it look like to them?
Probably some of them may know. You ask them if they can answer.
Leakage, they are already writing the answers, leakage and NVE. No, I don't actually agree with leakage and NVE. I got one correct answer, Dr. Venkat is correct. NV can be raised, NV can cross the vessel, IRMA does not cross the vessel.
Yes.
And IRMA does not block FFA, but FFA leaks. I think these are all correct answers.
Yes.
So, just to repeat what they said, please go ahead.
Can see the slit lamp biomicroscopy, the IRMA is always flat. It is within the surface of the retina. And neovascularization is always raised. It is above the surface of the retina. You can differentiate by slit lamp biomicroscopy. So it is very important to look the diabetic patient with the slit lamp biomicroscopy before you go ahead with the indirect ophthalmology. So let us.
Dr. Venkat has written OCT NVE can be raised. Venkat, if you are referring to a normal OCT, I think it can be seen, but I would suggest that we leave the OCT not as a finding for NVE. I could tell you something pre-retinal can be seen, but more on a FA, and it will be much better, easier to identify. And osteangiography also confuses what you are referring to. Osteangiography can also show that. Dr. Sushma has asked, Krishnendu, there's a question.
Yeah.
Does macular edema appears to be elevated? Does macular edema elevated while identifying it? It's not a fat flower pattern, but then how to identify? I think the answer is the question itself. That if you look again, a very nice look at the straight line biomicroscope with a 70 AD, it does appear elevated. You can see cystic spaces sometimes. Sometimes very subtle, you cannot make out. You keep looking at it, compare to the other eye, look at the whole contour over there, and you can see it elevated sometimes. This flower pattern thing is only a very nice thing to say. You will not see it all the time. Dr. Krishnendu, anything else you want to give a tip on CSM identification? No.
Well, it's a slit lamp, more or slit lamp biomicroscopy. If you can see, it is always, most of the cases, it is always elevated. You can see the cystic-like changes in the macula and easily identifiable. If you can see, you can identify the macular edema easily.
Yeah, we'll go ahead, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, and another most important, as per the ETDRS classification, you have to know what is clinically significant macular edema. But it is no longer in practice, but you should know the definition of clinically significant macular edema. So it is defined as any area of thickness, thickened area at or within 500 micron of the center, or one disc thickening of one disc diameter or larger if it is at least some part of it within one disc diameter of the center, hard exudate at or within 500 micron of the center, associated with adjacent retinal thickening. So three criteria to define the clinically significant macular edema. So this is must know, you must know in cases of diabetic macular edema. This is only theoretical nowadays. In next
I agree with him, and believe me, even after 20 years, I am a little confused on this all the time. But I can tell you, when I was a PG, I mugged it up. I knew how to draw it correctly, and I think there's a beautiful slides what Dr. Krishnendu has seen
black,
over here.
BLSCK.
And we need to definitely know this as a postgraduate. This is a definite question, answer, and I think it's one beautiful slides. This should be shared with all the PGs. Thank you, Krishnendu. We'll go to the next slide, please.
The new classification.
Can we request all the participants to please mute? All the participants to please mute your session.
This is a new classification of the diabetic macular edema. Mild, moderate, and severe depending upon the retinal thickening and hard exudate, how far it is from the posterior pole or the center of the macula. So mild if it is far away, moderate if it is approaching, and severe if it is at the center of the macula. This is the new classification of diabetic macular edema. Now, this is obvious, this is CSME, and OCT showing retinal thickening. So, as you have undergone the FFA class yesterday, this is focal macular edema, the focal leak at the macula, macular edema diffuse. This is the FFA-based classification of macular edema, focal, diffuse, cystic, cystoid macular edema, and ischemic. So these are the varieties of macular edema in diabetic patient in FFA. So this is FFA based classification of macular edema. So this is the investigation we often do in patient of diabetic macular edema. First is fundus photograph, angiography, contrast sensitivity, color sensitivity, OCT, and ultrasound. So investigation, dilated retinal investigation is a must. Within that, we should examine the slit lamp biomicroscopy and in-depth ophthalmoscopy. Fundus photograph, why should we take fundus photograph? To identify, for documentation, to note the progression, and to see the response of the treatment. See, what we you look for angiography in a patient of diabetic macular edema. Why we do angiography? To see the area of non-perfusion. and to see the microaneurysm leaking and presence of neovascularization. These are the three most important points in FFA while you do FFA in a patient of diabetic PDR, that is a proliferative diabetic macular edema or NPDR patient, to see the retinal ischemia, neovascularization, and microaneurysm or EDMAS. Now coming from FFA to OCT, why do OCT? To see the area, quantify the macular edema, presence of macular edema, differentiate different types of macular edema, whether it is tractional or non-tractional, and give the treatment to the patient. This is the classification of OCT pattern of macular edema in diabetic patient. First, focal or diffuse macular edema, spongy macular edema. Sometimes you can see the cystoid macular edema along with the serous detachment. Or the macular edema can be tractional due to dot posterior hyoid. Or it can be fractional detachment of the retina also. So this is how the OCT can classify the macular edema, that is the spongy, cystoid, serous detachment, dot posterior hyoid, and fractional detachment. So these are the five types of macular edema you often encounter in OCT in diabetic patients.
Dr. Randi, I'll stop you here. I'll ask you a question. I want to practice retina and I want to buy a OCT machine only. Is it advisable for me to practice diabetic maculopathy treatment, diabetic retinopathy treatment without a fluorescent machine?
Without OCT machine?
Yes.
No. It's better to, you should buy OCT, because many a times we often miss subtle finding like macular edema in our slit lamp biomicroscopy. So it's better you should have OCT if you are practicing or you are treating OCT. Diabetic macular edema patient.
What about fluorescein angiography?
Fluorescein angiography is also necessary. If you are confident enough in your slit lamp biomicroscopy and in that ophthalmoscopy, you avoid buying fluorescein angiography, but OCT is a must. OCT you should have.
So to understand, to treat diabetic maculopathy, diabetic retinopathy, and OCT is absolutely necessary to pick up small findings and also an angiography to complement in at least a few cases. Because yes, like what you showed in angiography, the ischemic maculopathy, unless I do an angiography, I will not find out. Yes. So that is what I was trying to explain. The focal and diffuse angiographic leakage, it really doesn't matter much on the OCT. I can pick up, decide vision, how much, how to inject, what to do. But to pick up that ischemic part, to pick up that subtle neovascularization, I think, like you said, an angiography is a good idea to have. One cannot rule out having an angiography in a diabetic retinopathy practice. I like you classified focal, diffuse, ischemic, combined kind of a thing. And the OCT also is showing such so many changes. We need to understand different definitions. Can we quickly just enumerate all the backwards?
One more point I would like to add to what you are already saying is that with an OCT, you can identify if there is vitromacular traction, because the macular edema may be present, but it may not respond to your treatment. And then you realize that there is vitromacular traction, and that is a very important indication for you to switch over to surgery. So I think that is also very important.
Yeah, I agree with you. Change protocol treatment, what he showed over here. So just to recapitulate, Dr. Gandhi, can you just show us all the OCT different classification what he just showed us? Can you just show us again?
Yes. This is the first P, where you can find the focal or diffuse leakage, cystoid edema, serous detachment, then...
So four different types over there. This is what Pooja showed us, what talked about dot macular VMT is what Pooja said. And the next slide is a total detachment of the retina over here. These are the two cases where injections and stuff will not work, surgery is the best option. That's what you're, Pooja, that's what you're referring to, right?
Yes, exactly. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Nandi. We'll move ahead.
Yes. The next investigation we do, the ultrasound, when the fundus view is not possible due to...
Sorry, yes. Krishnendu.
Yeah.
There is a question from Dr. Vaikat from Vizag. How to differentiate focal and diffuse macular edema on OCT? Now, I will answer your question with the permission of Dr. Nandi. And he made a very clear that the slide that he showed, focal and diffuse. Yeah. Obvious cysts over there, the small cystic lesions can be focal. If there is a huge amalgamation of them, I would assume they are diffuse. But Nindu, will you correct me on that? Anything
yes,
you want to
definitely.
Add to that?
That is the difference. Actually, the focal and diffuse term comes from angiography, not
FFA,
from OCT. Yes.
That's
so
true.
You cannot classify focal diffuse edema on OCT. It is actually the spongy fistula edema. So that's why I have written focal or diffuse edema. Or then cystoid edema. Then serostetinal detachment. So differentiating of focal and diffuse edema, actually we made through the FFA, not by OCT. But you can pick up, like in these two OCT. If you can see the first, this one is a focal edema. And this one is a diffuse edema. Or you can say the cystoid edema.
So, and the next one, the one, can you show that with the pointer? No, go back.
Sir.
Yeah, with the pointer, can you show that? Dr. Venkat, if you see the second last one, there is a neurosense detachment also, and there is a diffuse edema also. So, two different things can coexist with each other. So, what we classify so nice on the, you know, tabular format, clinically patients need not follow that all the time. They can have an amalgamation, there may be a dot highlight over there also. So, and we unfortunately use our terminology a little loosely, some angiography terminology in the OCT, in the OCT angiography. I agree that it's not right, but it is sometimes done very loosely. And this is a clear example of two different findings in the same patient in the same macula. I hope you're clear on that. Yeah, Dr. Nandi, thank you so much. Can you move ahead, please?
Yes. So, I was talking about the ultrasound, next modality of investigation, where we need ultrasound. When there is no view of posterior segment, or there is a, we are want to treat the vitreous hemorrhage, don't know whether there presence of fractional detachment in the retina or not. So this is the vitreous hemorrhage you often encounter in a patient of diabetes. See, there is a fractional flat fraction with a sub body, there is a hemorrhage behind the area of fractional detachment. So this is why we need ultrasound also in our investigative modality. Now, there is a treatment. Treatment, why we need to treat the patient to reduce the pus vessel hyperpermeability in a case of macular edema and to treat the neovascularization in a patient of proliferative diabetic retinopathy. So laser was the mainstay of treatment in diabetic macular edema previously, and now it is again a special treatment for PDR patient. So first you need to know few studies, very important study, where from the laser comes, the DRS, diabetic retinopathy study, and ETDRS in cases treating the clinically significant macular edema. So by heart you should know these two studies. These are the very important point. Shows the PRP laser, there is a photocoagulation, reduce the risk of severe vision loss by 50%. So that we should offer PRP in all patients of proliferative diabetic retinopathy. So you should be asked, what is the definition, what is the meaning of severe vision loss? 660 to 3/6. And why we need laser in PSCME? Because it is reduce the risk of moderate vision loss by 50% of the patient. Moderate vision loss is 6/18 to 6/16. So this is important landmark in patient of PDR and macular edema. Another study is vitrectomy study, DRVS, diabetic retinopathy vitrectomy study, which says early vitrectomy is essential if you see the vitreous hemorrhage non-resolving for 1 or 6 months. So this is the indication of diabetic vitrectomy where you often encounter, we often proceed with vitrectomy. Special situation where we offer PRP laser in spite of not having PDR. In cases of anterior segment, neovascularization, bilateral severe NPDR with high risk like pregnancy, hypertension, renal failure, elevated lipid level, one-eyed patient with severe NPDR or non-compliant patient, we offer laser therapy in this special situation to a non-PDR patient. And nowadays, we often treat our diabetes.
Yes. Dr. Nandi.
Yeah.
Just stop you a little bit over here.
Yeah.
Laser that you're talking about, is what is the kind of laser you're doing?
Important. It's very important question in Viva double frequency NDR laser.
Double frequency NDR laser. And you said PRP. What do you mean by PRP?
Pan retinal photocoagulation.
And so that means all of the retina. And normally over how many settings do you do it?
Actually, we divide the setting in 3 to 4 settings. Now, which part of the
fallback?
Yes.
And supposing you have an ideal patient. Sorry. Yeah. Go ahead.
No, then PG should ask, should answer the question, which part of the retina we should do the laser first in PRP first sitting?
Inferior Rajini. Excellent, Dr. Rajini.
And why we should do laser inferior?
So we have Dr. Rajini, Dr. Swami, Dr. Madhuri, Dr. Tanuja. So the question is, why inferiorly first? I'll answer. So that, because if there is vitreous hemorrhage while you're doing laser and he will come inferiorly, then you're going to do laser inferiorly. Laser, yeah, excellent, or else vitreous hemorrhage, very nice. Bleeding, Vishwanath Pratap, Dr. Tanuja, Rajini, excellent. No, if bleeding doesn't prevent superior, exactly. Because it will settle down, you got a unity also. So we have 5-6 people listening to this very carefully, Dr. Krishnendu. And I would also ask you, so approximately how many burns do you put per sitting approximately?
Approximately 700 to 800 burns per sitting.
Sorry, 800 burns. And so if you have a very ideal patient, transport is not an issue. We'll come back whenever the patient, you want the patient to come back. How long, what is the gap you would normally like to keep?
At least 3 to 4 days interval.
4 to 4 days to a week is what you would like to keep interval.
Yes. Yes.
Within a day or two is not really advisable.
Now, if the patient is outstation patient, then...
No. I am talking about ideal patient, ghar ke bagal mein rehta hai, not very outstation. I am talking about ideal patient.
3 to 4 days, yeah. Or 7 days.
7 days, 4 to 7 days. Now, same ideal patient, I am a junior consultant or a senior fellow, and if I do very heavy burns for this patient, very heavy burns in the first, and the patient is hypertensive. What complication can I do in doing very poor, very heavy, lots of burns I put in? What complication can I create?
First complication we can create, that is the serous exudative retinal detachment and serous choroidal detachment. The patient comes next day with a huge serous choroidal detachment or internally exudative detachment.
Is Dr. Pooja there? Dr. Pooja Sinha?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Dr. Pooja, we were discussing if I do a laser very poorly, a PRP laser for a diabetic in a PDR patient. So we said we'll have a serous detachment. And supposing I have a patient, we are going ahead in this. Okay. I will ask another question. Dr. Nandi? In this era of anti-VEGF, and what you're showing is steroid injections, I focal laser, does it have a role? Do you know laser for focal laser? So many studies talk about injection. Does focal laser still have a role in some patients?
Definitely, focal laser has very good role to play even in the era of injection. Like if the patient have very good vision, we cannot inject that patient. 6-9, 6-6 vision, till you are finding there is a macular edema, then focal laser has a role to play. Second case, if it is the edema is extrafoveal, if you can see there is a mesarcinate hard exudate with a leaking microangiom, just extrafoveal, then definitely focal laser has a role to play. So it is not obsolete. It is definitely there. We have to use it adequately and adjust patient to patient.
We can modify that by saying if it, there's a non-center involved macular edema, I think focal laser has a really good role.
We will leave that alone. Those are terminology will confuse them. That is confusing for them. I agree with you. That is a new terminology. I'll put it, this very nice question has come up. Once you've completed PRP, Dr. Pooja, and you've done a good job, and when do you normally call your patients back? After how long?
So, in my practice, when I was doing, I was a fellow, we used to do PRP over 3 days. But now, in my clinical practice, I have a feeling that sometimes, or invariably, there is some amount of maculopathy or macular edema involved in these patients, even if there is a new NV elsewhere and we are doing a PRP. So it's always better to tackle your macular edema first with an anti-VEGF and add a nasal PRP first. And then slowly, in a phased manner, you finish your temporal quadrant. So you do your inferior PRP and you do your nasal PRP.
The question is a little different. Let's say it's an ideal patient. You have done laser once a week, over 3 weeks, no hurry, not 3 days continuously. After you finish the laser in these three settings, patient belongs to Patna, will follow you very correctly, not a well-controlled diabetic. After finishing the PRP, how long do you call back the patient?
After finishing the PRP, I would call the patient back again after 2 to 3 weeks.
2 to 3 weeks. When do you complete and you check up and you feel things are moving ahead fine?
I have made sure that there is no macular edema involved. That is an important thing.
We agree there is no macular edema. At what I'm trying to define here is, at what point do you feel your new vessels will regress and you will say your PRP has worked very well? After how many months?
I would call the patient on a monthly interval for the first 2 or 3 months.
Right.
And keep following up the patient and even the other eye of the patient, and also keep checking his systemic control. This is something which we have to remember.
I agree to exactly what you're saying. What I'm going to drive home a point is, normally if I've done a good PRP, from finishing my PRP to the 3 months to 4 month period, if I find all the nuances regressed, I can then rest easy. But like Dr. Pooja said, systemic control, other eye control, injections in between, for the first 2-3 months, be very careful, keep calling your patient again and again, but do not declare that your PRP is successful at least 3 months to see the whole scarring has occurred and US has regressed or not. If necessary, add on the PRP again. That's the point I was trying to make over here. The 3 months is the period at which we can sort of confidently say that, assume again, like Dr. Pooja said, systemic control is good, patients willing to follow up again, at the end of 3 months, you can see your PRP has worked out very well. Because that is the question that we had. Shall we go ahead, Dr. Krishnendu? Shall we go ahead?
Yes, so these are the new modalities of treating the diabetic macular edema. A lot of injection nowadays, we often give the patient. So this is a busy slide showing a lot of studies. Actually, probably not in the curriculum of the post-graduation, I don't know. So the main conclusion of these studies shows that the definitely visual improvement occurs with injection. And it reduces the central retinal thickness. And we have to continue the treatment for a prolonged period of time. It is not 1 month, 2 month, or 1 year affair. We have to continue seeing or injecting the patient for a long period of time, like 5 years. So this is the response of anti-VEGF in a patient of diabetic macular edema, which gradually improves over time. How often we inject? Monthly. If you give ranibizumab or bevacizumab or aflibercept, it should be monthly injection. So I'm not going to protocols. Other than anti-VEGF, we have steroid also, like dexamethasone implant. So people should ask you, what is the dose of dexamethasone implant? So where we give the steroid in patient of diabetic macular edema, actually, we prefer to give steroid in a diabetic patient in a resistant cases, not as a primary treatment. But often we have to give steroid in a primary treatment also, but some that is different. But here we actually prescribe Ozurdex in patient of resistant macular edema where they are not responding to anti-VEGF. Now,
There is a question. Okay, we'll go to Sushma's question a little later on. Dr. Sushma has asked, sir, after how many injections we would like to shift to another intravitreal? Dr. Sushma, I'll come back to the question later on. I have a question to everybody in the audience. In India, since when, which year are we using anti-VEGF injections? Which year did we start anti-VEGF injections? Avastin is the one we use first, made by Roche company, which is bevacizumab, which you can use in multiple patients at the same time. It works out cheaper. A Roche bottle, I think, costs around 24,000 rupees. You can use a small quantity for multiple patients. Dr. Krishnendu, I will ask you, request you, if you can just, 0.05 ml is the amount, 0.05 ml is the amount we give from the vial, and that helps us understand, get it under control. Like Dr. Krishnendu said, on a week, monthly basis, I get a new patient of, let's say, the uppermost one that he has shown, the OCT, in that previous slide itself. And I give maybe two injections, and I see that there is no response at all. But then I will discuss with my patient, and I, of course, I understand that my patient has some good systemic control. HbA1 is more or less okay. The blood pressure control is more or less okay. Then I will think of switching injections. But at least 2 to 3 injections every month, and then only switch injections to from anti-VEGF to a steroid. Devashmita said 2007. No, I gave my first anti-VEGF in 2006. Right. No, Devashmita, I remember it was in November 2006 that I gave my first injection. And I know a few centers in India had given before that also. So by August 2006, we were using it in India. I will not ask a question. I'll ask you a question. Which institute or where in the US or who proposed the idea of Avastin first? I think it's something you can go back in Indian history. It's interesting how people think of these new things and where did they use it first. My first patient of Avastin was in a patient, I was very scared, in a patient of neovascular glaucoma. And it was a patient who had just developed neovascular glaucoma around 10 days before. And it was a desperate patient, and he was ready for any treatment. And I said, this is a new thing, experimental drug which has come. They may imagine, this is 14 years ago. And I gave him the injection like a miracle. Within 3 days, he said, I can see better. I saw there was no neovascularization, and I was shocked. And I remember a few weeks later, I was Dr. Mangat Dogar at a session, and he showed me multiple slides that starts working within 2-3 days itself. Especially the neovascularization starts regressing. So, mind you, we've come a long way since 14 years, and we now have what Dr. Nandi said. We've had bevacizumab. We also have aflibercept now. Aflibercept is Eylea, which the molecule structure is a little different. But as of today, we use bevacizumab, ranibizumab, and aflibercept. Of course, there are some people use Zif aflibercept also, which is a similar molecule like how bevacizumab, ranibizumab. You have Zif aflibercept also. You can use Zaltrap, which is it is called. This is also used by a lot of people, and it works equally well. Efficacy part of it is good in all of them. The sensitivity and the reaction infection part is a little doubtful in some of them, especially in Avastin. We're a little scared of that, but it can be used very safely in lots of patients, and we have over 40 years experience all over the world using these injections. Dr. Nandi, would you like to add anything else to that?
No, nothing. You have briefed it excellently.
Shall we move ahead?
Yes. So I was talking about the vitrectomy. A bit of vitrectomy in cases of non-clearing vitreous hemorrhage. How long we should wait? At least for 3 months we should wait, because sometimes it clears by its own. But if you see there is a tractional retinal detachment, you should go ahead with the surgery early. So what are the indication of vitrectomy? Non-clearing vitreous hemorrhage, tractional detachment, combined retinal detachment, and sometimes macular edema associated with dot posterior hyoid, where injection doesn't work. This is the indication of vitrectomy in diabetic patient. So these are the few pre-op and post-op picture where we go ahead with the surgery in a patient of diabetic. There is a tractional detachment.
Dr. Nandi, with the go back to previous slide. I think these are beautiful slides. Yeah, in the first one, the color photos, the pre-op and post-op one. Yeah, stay here, please. So this is lovely. I think you've done a great job in these patients. So in the uppermost one, with a pointer, can you show the fibrous prolif over there? The flag, yeah. This whole area is covered the macula. It's widespread. There are no laser marks, nothing at all. So this is a patient who's come with a very advanced diabetic retinopathy with a PDR, with a taut posterior hyoid membrane, with a thick fibrous, flat fibrous prolif, obscuring his macula. I don't know why he waited for so long. And we'll go on to the next slide. Your post-op photograph of that with your pointer, please. Yeah, you can see that the supratemporal vessel is, you cannot make out the content. Yeah, that is the upper one, it's the sclerosis, the one which, So there onwards, you cannot see it. It's black and white are the laser scars, so it's much after. But the macula looks very good. So only to show and to impress upon all of you that vitrectomy is difficult. Results are always not very good. But always, you always have patients like this where if you do a good dissection, you can get a very, very good reasonable amount of vision. That's the upper one. Can we go to the next, the pre-op, second slide in the left side, please, Dr. Yeah. The extensive membrane in the left eye coming, yes, in the infratemporally along the superior arcade, all over the thick hard exudate just above the fovea. The hard exudate, can show the hard exudate. Yeah. So this is a very, very difficult case because there is so much happening over here. No laser done, nothing, some laser on top. So you can see the superotemporal vessel is totally sclerosed. There's no blood flow in that. In the post-op photograph. Krishan, can you show that post-op photograph? Yeah, there is no blood supply in that. But all the membranes are gone. Can you make out all the, there's no membranes there. And especially inferotemporally, you can see there's nothing there at all, which you see preoperatively. So this is a good surgery again. Dissection has been done very nicely. And a patient will have ambulatory vision, if not good vision, to at least do his own work. My macula is quite clear, some hard exudates. And this is a patient, the lowermost one on the right side, extensive, large. Can you show the pointer, please, Dr. Nandi? Yeah. This is a very bad case. Extensive membranes all over. Can't make out the arcade. Vessels not seen. Disc obscured. Just pretty bad. So here, at least, of course, the disc is quite pale, but it's been a wonderful surgery because everything, the whole retina has cleared up over there, and things look much better. There is a question, Dr. Nandi, from Dr. Charul. Why sclerosis occurs? I'm assuming she's asking why those blood vessels get occluded. So,
yeah, because of leukostasis. Because there is I have explained in pathogenesis, there is a two pathology going on simultaneously. Either there is occlusion or there is a leakage. So, due to the diabetic end product, it get occluded, leukostasis, there is a roughness of the endothelium, and the blood cells, the sucker element, get attached to the blood vessel, and there is a result in occlusion. So that is why,
like he said, what sir has shown and what Kansky photograph of this pathophysiology, I still think is the best photograph ever. Whatever journals you read, whatever books you read, the Kansky photograph, what even sir has shown, what Anandi has shown, I think exactly the thickening of the basement membrane and the accumulation of lipids over there, accumulation of thickening of erythrocytes over there, I think all that together leads to the sclerosis and why you get occlusion of the vessel. Do you use silicone oil in some of your patients for surgery, Dr. Dandi?
See the glistening thing? This is the silicone oil.
So, silicone oil. So, when there is a very bad detachment, the retina is very thin, you do use silicone oil. That's why I thought it was very shiny reflex you had over here. So, silicone oil was put to the side to keep the retina attached. So, this is a vitrectomy done, membrane peeling done, fluid gas exchange done, silicone oil injected, and endo laser done. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Right. So, this is very nicely done surgery. Congratulations. Can we go to the next slide, please? Thank you so much.
So apart from the eye control, we have to go for systemic control. Systemic control is important. That is the control of glycosylated hemoglobin. We should keep it around or below 7. Important. Keep your cholesterol under normal, blood pressure under normal, and stop smoking and drinking. Dietary advice is very important. Why it is important to control the glycosylated hemoglobin? Because it reduces the death due to diabetes in 21% of the cases. 37% microvascular complication like eye and kidney. And myocardial infarction in 14% of the cases if you reduce the glycosylated hemoglobin 1%. So it is very important to control the sugar, mostly the glycosylated hemoglobin. And follow-up. Follow-up is very important. If you don't have any changes in the eye, you follow up yearly. If you have changes in the eye, like retinopathy, you call the patient very early. Like if it's non-retinopathy to mild moderate retinopathy, 3-monthly interval, severe NPDR, then monthly to 3-monthly interval, you should follow up the patient. So follow-up is again important, whether you treat or don't treat. At conclusion, eye examination is very important, but whenever you see the patient of diabetic retinopathy, also check the systemic control of blood sugar, blood pressure, and blood lipid to avoid blindness. Thank you.
Is Dr. Pooja there? Is Dr. Pooja there, please?
Yes,
yeah,
sir.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks, Pooja. So, coming back to a few more, we just started from very the whole presentation again. So, supposing you have a 21-year-old patient, and very illiterate, not very sure of what's happening, comes and says, "I'm seeing these rotors, and in the one eye, the other eye is absolutely fine," and you look inside. And you see that this is a PDR, and patient has no idea what's happening, and it's a very illiterate patient, not very intelligent, not very careful, and you see one eye PDR, other eye severe NPDR. Now, this patient is one patient. The other patient that you have, 60-year-old, very intelligent, first time seen diabetic patient, just diagnosed diabetes at the age of 60.
I can't hear your voice. Sir, I can't hear your voice.
Can you hear us? Dr. Nandi?
Yes, yes, I'm there.
Dr. Saurabh Sinha, you are there?
Probably he has lost connection. Probably he will come back.
Okay.
Yeah, I lost connection, correct. So, shall I continue? I'm sorry, I lost connection.
You can continue the two scenarios.
I'm so sorry. Can we have people mute their mics, please? Dr. Sara, can you please mute your mic? Yeah, thank you. Dr. Pooja is there?
Yes, I'm there, sir. Yes. Very much.
Yeah. So two scenarios. Let's begin by one. This is a 60-year-old man, by the diabetes. He's diagnosed diabetes at the first time, and you've done a vision in 6-6-N6. Fundus, you see, is totally normal. Nothing is there. What do you advise this man? Rather, ask a specific question. You see a normal fundus, very clear vision, 6-6-N6. He has no complaint, he has come to you because he's a diabetic, diagnosed recently by his diabetologist and sent to you. You have seen his vision. What would you, in his prescription, advise, what will you write?
If there is, this is a 60-year-old man with no diabetic retinopathy.
No.
Okay, so then if the if his glycosylated hemoglobin is more or less satisfactory and their fundus is absolutely normal, I would call him maybe after 6 months.
6 months to a year is what we'll call him back. I know, yes. Why we say 6 months is because when you say 6 months, they will come after a year only. So most patients should come back in a year's time. Even though, and I know practically we say 6 months, come 6 months, you know they will come back in a year's time at least. If you say 1 year, they will come in 2 years' time. So I agree with Dr. Pooja that a patient with no diabetes finding, I will not advise OCT, I will advise nothing at all. I find no findings. 6 and 6 patients, no visual complaints. I will do no tests. At the maximum, if you are very aggressive, you can do a color photo to diagnose no diabetes, which may be done, but I'm not very particular about it. But I'll call back after 6 to 1 year. Dr. Pooja, same patient comes back after the year, still no complaints, 6 and 6, maintaining HbA1c 6.5. He's a very good patient, walks every day in the morning, very well controlled. But this time you see 2-3 microaneurysms in both the eyes, nothing else. At the macular, 2-3 microaneurysms, no visual complaints, 6 and 6 vision. What will advise this patient?
So when, now we know that slowly over a year, period of 1 year, some amount of retinopathy has cropped in the patient's eye. So now you have to be a little bit more careful. You definitely do a color fundus photograph at this moment. Tell the patient that, okay, 1 year back you had nothing, but now you have these early changes of diabetic retinopathy. You educate him, show him pictures. And then I think, considering his age, I would maybe then call him between 2 to 3 months again, and then keep checking his fundus picture. And if there is some amount of maculopathy at any
time... Go slow. One by one. Very, very, very nicely put. You will check his HbA1c. And this patient, three magazines, both eyes, you call him back in 4 months' time or 6 months' time, mild NPDR. Now, same person comes after 5 months and says, doctor, right eye, reading vision is little bit less. This is more or less okay. Left eye is still fine. I have no issues. This is complaints. On checkup, you find 6-9 part and 8 in right eye. No cataract. What will you advise this patient test-wise? What test should you advise for?
at this moment, definitely we need to get an OCT done.
OCT first. Right, yes. OCT first. So you do an OCT. Will you do an angiography in this patient? I know it's a very debatable question. Some will say, I will first time do, I will do an OCT angiography. So I will not go into that, but OCT is an absolutely mandatory in this patient. And then take a call based on OCT, whether you want angiography or not. And we will not get to the treatment part of it also over here. Now I'll go back to my first statement that I made. 21-year-old, no investigations done, has come to you because you're an ophthalmologist saying, in the right eye, I am seeing a lot of floaters. I have poor vision in the right eye. And left eye is absolutely fine. Your examination, indirect ophthalmoscopy 70-80 shows, right eye, definite PDR with vitreous hemorrhage. Macula looks little bit, CSME is also there. And left eye, some NPDR changes. In this patient, what tests will you do for the right eye? There's definite vitreous hemorrhage and CSME.
So, firstly, before any tests, I would ask the patient to get his whole systemic evaluation done because he's a young patient. So, I would send him to the diabetologist. And at the same time, I would say that, okay, your eye examination also has to be hurried up. But I want your complete diabetic profile and an opinion from your diabetologist. And you come back to me again after 2 days. And at this moment, because he has macular edema and he has vitreous hemorrhage as well, I would definitely have an anti-VEGF in my mind.
No. We're in a treatment. No. We are not going to treatment now. Okay. We are talking only investigations, not treatment. So investigations for the right eye, left eye.
So investigations for the right eye would definitely be an OCT if the view is still reasonably all right. Because if there is vitreous hemorrhage, I know that there are new vessels elsewhere or, which are bleeding. So I will not bother to do an FFA except if I have to look for an ischemic change in the periphery.
Right. So Dr. Pooja has mentioned some things very, very nicely, so many things. She says if there's a lot of vitreous hemorrhage, an OCT will not help. If there is less vitreous hemorrhage, OCT will definitely help, which she made very correctly. She also said angiography, if there is less vitreous hemorrhage, may help me show the ischemia over here. I will now stop over here and ask you if the other eye has hemorrhages here and there. Clinically, it looks like severe NPDR. In this patient, what tests would you advise for?
So this is, I'm sure you're driving at what I'm thinking about. If the patient has elements of PDR in the other eye, and in the first eye you have severe NPDR, you have to be having that element of, proliferative disease in mind. So you have to look for a subtle NVE in this kind of a patient, especially in young patients.
I agree with you. The reason is yesterday's talk, Dr. Manisha was very particular. She says, if I find one has NVD, NVE, I'm not worried about that. I know what the diagnosis is. I'm worried about the good eye, which looks good, may not be so good by looking for some very subtle changes. I do accept what Dr. Krishnendu said. Dr. Krishnendu is there. Dr. Nandi? Yeah.
Yes, I'm there.
He mentioned, you mentioned about high risk characteristics. And I insist that for postgraduates, it's absolutely important that HRC or PDR is a question asked all the time. 4-to-1 rule is asked all the time in all case presentations, in all discussions, in all theory papers also. To me, and I ask you, in clinical practice, how much importance do you give to this 1/4 disc diameter, half disc diameter NVD for your treatment protocol? Do you really give it much importance, sir?
Once you cross the MS exam, this doesn't have any role to play in private practice or any kind of practice. Any kind of neovasculation, if you see in patient of diabetic retinopathy, go ahead with the laser. Whatever it may be, the size, 1/4, 1/2, 1/3, you have to do laser, like in this picture.
Yeah. So the reason I brought this point, and I know Pooja was also smiling, that this we have a lot of classifications, a lot of definitions we have, and unfortunately, please understand all these classific definitions are made by the Western world where the healthcare system is totally different. Their patient compliance is much better. We are defining things as per their classifications, but practice protocols the quality of diabetic patients we have is totally different over here. So sometimes we will end up mugging up something here. You see practically something else, which is why Dr. Pooja, she said so nicely, I call in 6 months. She's saying it from her clinical experience. She knows when you say one year, sir, ek saal ka do saal. This is a very common thing. So I agree with Dr. Nandi that this half disc diameter, one disc diameter on the disc of NVD NV is not really of much significance. Any neovascularization treated like a PDR and advised protocol like a PDR. Now, I will just ask a few questions to the audience. Yeah. This laser that has been done, this is a PRP laser. Has anybody heard what is a Pascal laser? If anybody can write down Pascal laser. Yeah. Any questions, any queries? Otherwise, we can close the... discussion for today. Yeah, Dr. Priyanka's pattern scanning is a agree with her. So Dr. Kishan, any comments that you would like? Dr. Satyajit, sir, sorry, we'll not involve you today. I will ask you a question. I'll ask you a question. You are really patient as duty for cataract surgery. You have seen the patient
come again.
NS2 to 3+, vision is around 660. NS2 plus 660 vision. So you are thinking okay. This is not fitting in. The amount of cataract is not so much 660 vision. And then you see inside that definitely there's diabetic retinopathy. Will you do cataract surgery?
Mm-hmm. Now we'll first see what exactly the pathology is, and then first we'll manage the diabetic retinopathy part, whatever the pathology is there. After the management, then only we'll take up the cataract surgery. Suppose there's the diabetic macular edema or something is there, then the retina colleague has to take care of that first, and then we'll undertake the cataract surgery, because we do not want to worsen the situation.
Absolutely correct. This is the point of what Dr. Satyajit said is, if you see any good amount of diabetic retinopathy changes and patient is insisting on treatment for the cataract, my strong suggestion that one should not do any kind of surgery for a patient with any diabetic maculopathy or diabetic retinopathy of some extent that is very obvious to you, especially when the vision is not correlated to the amount of cataract. It's important that it treats the retina first, then for cataract surgery. Would you like to put any point on diabetes and glaucoma, any correlation, Dr. Satyajit?
The incidence of glaucoma is higher in diabetics, as has been documented in the studies. And we would also like to, in all these diabetics, it's very important to do a proper glaucoma examination and do a gonioscopy and all the relevant examinations before you actually undertake the cataract surgery.
There's a question from Dr. Sushma, for Dr. Nandi. Can you suggest a book for FFA and OCT? Dr. Sushma has asked, Dr. Nandi.
You read your textbook, that will be enough.
Now, what? Which book?
Yanoff is an excellent book. Yanoff, if you want to read. Yanoff is a single book. And if you read also in details, we used to have A.K. Datta in our time, A.K. Datta.
Dr. Pooja, any recommendations for what books? F.A. O.C.T.? Dr. Pooja, any recommendations?
I think Yanoff is an excellent book. Yanoff, Kansky, all these are very good textbooks.
I am a pure go Indian person. The textbooks which are from Shankar Netale for FA OCT ultrasound are excellent textbooks. I think they are cheap. They all cost around 1,000 rupees, 1,200 rupees. Each book is excellent. There's a book on uveitis. The Shankara series on each disease is absolutely fine. the textbook on angiography by the PGI group, Dr. Vaishali and Dr. Amod Gupta on OCT is also an excellent textbook. They are very cheap Indian textbooks.
So if you're looking for the benefit of the PGs, let's make a list and then we can post it to you. So I think the that may be what they are looking for.
Dr. Randi, there's a question. I agree with you. Dr. Charul has asked a question, Anandi. Role of topical NSAIDs in macular edema. I will stick to diabetic macular edema. Can you treat diabetic edema? No.
No.
So he's answered no, even if I have finished my question. So there is no role for topical NSAIDs in diabetic macular edema. I repeat myself, there is no role for topical NSAIDs in diabetic macular edema. I am not getting into post-catastrophic macular edema and all those things. There's a question by...
Please ask them how to differentiate the diabetic macular edema from the post-cataract surgery macular edema, as they have the class of FFA yesterday.
Yeah. So Dr. Nandi has asked a question now, how to differentiate between on angiography, how to differentiate between anything. No, there's before this the thing goes up. One second. The question went a bit. Should be cataract, should we go for PRP first or go ahead cataract surgery then to PRP? Will anti-VEGF be combined? So, actually the question went away, it goes up. Dr. Nandi, there was a question. So, patient has PDR and cataract. So, would you do laser first or cataract surgery first?
If the view is visible, definitely treat the diabetic retinopathy first before undergoing any kind of surgery. If you cannot view the retina properly, then you go ahead with the cataract surgery. So always treat the diabetic retinopathy before you treat anything else.
So would you take over anti-VEGF if possible? Is what the question was.
Anti-VEGF to be given if you have diabetic macular edema.
Right.
If you have diabetic macular edema, not as to treat the PDR, but to treat macular edema, if the view is there, definitely you treat the macular edema first before.
So to answer your question, Dr. Nandi, Dr. Rohit has answered nicely. Disc leak in post catastrophe macular edema on FA. Disc leakage will be there.
Why?
So Dr. Rohit, his question is why? Anjan says, thank you, sir. Disc leak in this. Dr. Pooja, any comments, anything else we can close for today?
I think we've had a very good talk, very exhaustive. And now in the era of anti-VEGF, the question which was last asked was, in the era of anti-VEGF, if the view is so bad that you are not able to do a laser, you can definitely do a cataract surgery. And sometimes people say in the same sitting, you can give an anti-VEGF or you can give it even 1 week post cataract surgery. If you feel that there is edema on OCT, macular edema, very hazy view, but the cataract is significant, you cannot do a laser.
Yeah, these are little comfort zone, affordability, all sorts of different patients, different kinds. But I will just add one more. Dr. Nandi, we all practice in the far periphery. Sometimes we have a lot of poor patients. What I think he had shown in his initial slide is triamcinolone also he had mentioned. Dr. Nandi, do you inject triamcinolone intravitreal once in a while for a patient who cannot afford?
Very, very, very rare. Very rare. Of its adverse effects like glaucoma.
Glaucoma. So he's a good glaucoma person. So if you create glaucoma, he will take care. It's as high as between 20 to 30% of patients will get. Between 20 to 30% kind of patient can have glaucoma, IPTA, and 2 milligram can be injected. And it does work very well, and it can cause a lot of cataract. Dr. Pooja, do you use IPTA once in a while? Rarely?
I do. I do use preservative-free triamcinolone once in a while. And fortunately for me, we have not had many IOP issues with it. So patients with very severe macular edema, not responding to anti-VEGF therapy.
Yeah.
Sorry, so IBT, was I lost in between? So patients with very severe macular edema not responding to anti-VEGF therapy and pseudophakic patients, I do give transtenone once in a while and it works.
Right. So IVTS of the we had not covered earlier. We missed that. But Nandi, you mentioned any word of caution, Dr. Nandi, for a patient of recent, just once, I lead on to Charles' question, recently in OPD, 36-year-old male diabetic, 20 years of incident vision, 6 years combined slight blood vision on OCT, minimal cystic macular edema. He was only on Megabrom, eye drop, Neurobion, 4th OD. So in such case, what will the treatment? So I'll answer the question, Dr. Charul. If OCT shows minimal cystic macular edema, like you mentioned, minimal cystic macular edema vision is 6-6, because it's not fitting in. If you are saying vision is 6-6, then he should not come in a slightly blurred vision, because 6-6 shouldn't say that. So these are, again, very borderline cases, near vision, I'll take reconstruction. I wouldn't bet on Megabrom working on his case. So I would rather check my vision again and check the OCT again. Call him back in 2 weeks time, a month's time, and treat it accordingly. So your question of vision slightly blurred with 6-6, I'm assuming it's a borderline case. Wait for a month, see what happens. But Megabrom in these patients will not work. And Dr. Chandi was very clear about it. I agree with him. Neurobion, photo, Megabrom need to make us happy, not patient. Patient spends money, we feel happy, we've done something. But we are just buying time for a month. I was asking a different question to Nandi. Supposing you have a patient who is just two patients waiting in your OPD today, different history of heart attack, myocardial infarction, one, and the other patient says I had a stroke, a cerebral axial accident, both say they had a month ago, and both clinically have CSME. What injection would you advise, avoid, do for them?
So in our practice, as per the published literature, if you have a patient of stroke, heart attack, you should avoid giving anti-VEGF injections within 3 months of the event. Suppose the patient having the heart attack or cerebral stroke in the January, you cannot give the injection till March. So in between that, you have to opt for other kind of injection like Ozudex, like IVT, but not anti-VEGF, because it can precipitate further attack of stroke or heart attack. So avoid giving anti-VEGF in those patients having history of stroke, heart attack within recent past 3 months.
So this is something which is being, I think one should keep in mind, 3 months. Some of our colleagues say 4 months, some will say 6 months, but minimum 3 months. Before that, no injection of anti-VEGF. So anybody advising anti-VEGF injection, please do take history of stroke or heart attack in the last 3 months. That's very important, because we cannot be held liable for any of these things. We don't afford to miss these things. Dr. Satyajit, any other statements, comments?
I think it's been well covered by Dr. Krishnendu, and the discussion which you have done makes it even more interesting. And Dr. Pooja has also contributed well in the discussion. Can we end the session now? Because it's almost 1.5 hours.
Yeah.
Okay, I'd like to thank Dr. Krishnendu for the beautiful presentation. Thank you, Dr. Saurabh Sinha.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Even the first presentation was great. Even the second one was amazing. I'm also very grateful to Dr. Pooja and as always, to Intas. Tomorrow, the class will be on vitreous hemorrhage. I, Dr. Saurabh Sinha himself, who was until now the moderator, tomorrow he will be the faculty teacher. And tomorrow also, in addition to vitreous hemorrhage, we'll have a talk on Dr. Pranab, who is a consultant at the Center of Sight, Kolkata. So both the presentations will be there, and we are looking forward to a very informative class tomorrow on vitreous hemorrhage. Thank you so much, Dr. Shashikant Sharma ji, for introducing all the speakers and handling this every day. Thank you, Intas. Thank you, Dr. Krishnendu. Thank you, Dr. Saurabh. Thank you, Dr. Pooja Sinha.
Dr. Saurav, so it will be a challenge for Dr. Saurav to be presenting and moderating as well tomorrow.
Because you know, I can say whatever I can give it whatever.